Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Glenn Whitney for the National Museum of Mathematics, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this evening's element of the harmonic series, officially sold out tonight. And now for the official part, I need to remind you to please silence any devices that might otherwise make noise this evening. So introducing the second element of something is both easier and harder than introducing the first. Easier because the stakes are lower. A number of you were here last time and already have some idea what this is all about. And harder because, of course, I've already said my piece in the first introduction. So fortunately, I am off the hook for the most part because I'm under strict instructions from the host to keep my remarks under 60 seconds because tonight's program is so packed. So I will limit it to just this. I personally have been waiting for this performance of the series for a very long time, because one of the most singular mathematical experiences of our lifetime was the settling of something that's known as an open problem or an unsolved mystery of mathematics, one that had lasted for 350 years from a small remark written in the margin of a number theory book by Fermat, so-called Fermat's Last Theorem, finally settled in the early 2000s by Andrew Wiles and others. And so tonight we're going to hear about a musical open question posed by the great violin maker Stradivarius. I suppose you could paraphrase his open question as, why will no violin ever sound as good as mine? So we're absolutely delighted at the museum to have Bruce Adolph as the host of Harmonic Series. Bruce is a composer who has been associated with the Lincoln Center Chamber Music Society for over 20 years, and he's also known as Public Radio's piano puzzler. Please join me in welcoming Bruce Adolph.
Hello. Before I introduce our guests, because I'm a piano puzzler, I have to do one piano puzzler to start. It's a good way to warm up, and it's just a way for you to warm up. Basically, it's a puzzle. If you've heard it on the radio, it's going to be a tune you probably know in the style of someone who did not have anything to do with that tune. So this is just a warm-up, a way to relax, break the ice. I know there's no ice, but just the feeling of it. So I'll play it for you, and then we can discuss it. It also is slightly mathematical in that it is all the accents are displaced. So if you can figure out where the accents are supposed to go, which time signature it should be in, you'll recognize the tune. The answer to that? Yes. It's your favorite. Well, thank you so much. I mean, my favorite things. Yes, my favorite things is the tune. And what about the style of that piece? Actually, that's a very, it's not who I was thinking, but that's a perfectly reasonable idea, Khachaturian, and slightly a little bit stranger than who it is, because he's not as well known. Yes.
Bartok?
Yes, Bartok. It was kind of like the Bartok Romanian dances, which of course is a Khachaturian kind of thing to do too. Very good. Now, the overall plan today is you're going to be hearing a lot about making violins, using technology to make violins that are like the great Stradivarius instruments and sometimes perhaps better. So one thing to think about is artifacts from the Italian Renaissance being made now using technology. And I came across a very interesting fact from the Venice Biennale of 2011. There's a Swiss artist named Urs Fischer who had this idea to take Gian Bognola created a fantastic, famous sculpture, The Rape of the Sabine Women. You may have seen this. It's three characters, and it's a very famous sculpture. What he wanted to do was recreate it so it looked exactly the same, as if it were made of marble, but make it out of wax and have, out of the fingertips and the hair, little wicks so he could set it on fire. And it would burn slowly for 5 days. And he did it. How did he do it? How did he take this Renaissance Italian artifact and create it now so it looked exactly the same except it was burning? Was that they used a 3D printer. They scanned, they did an optical scan of the original statue in Florence and then printed it in wax. You might also know now, speaking of 3D printers, that at the University of California at Irvine just a few months ago, they determined that you can take your smartphone, record a 3D printer printing, and the sound, if you play it back to another 3D printer, can print the same thing. This is very scary. They did it with a key to see if they, you can copy a key by sound, and you can. I just thought I'd throw that out there. There's also, as I'm building towards our guest and his incredible work, there's also something out there called the 3D Varius, not a Stradivarius, but a 3D Varius, which is actually nothing as interesting as what we're going to hear about today, but it's I'm building toward it. A French physicist and violinist, there are such things, such as Einstein, only this guy is no Einstein, but anyway, his name is Laurent Benadac, and he created a 3D Varius, which is a resin violin, but it doesn't really look like a violin. It's one of those kind of rock violins. You know, it's got a weird shape, and it's got a fingerboard and a scroll, and it has strings on it, but you have to plug it in, and it's electronic, and he plays on that, but it can't play any real violin repertoire, because if you unplug it, it doesn't sound like anything. However, our guests today are going to be handling real instruments and talking about extraordinary things. You have short bios in your program. Samuel Sigmundowicz is one of the great violin makers of this huge renaissance of violin making in the world today. You have a short bio there, but I want to add a few things. He has made violins for Isaac Stern, so he's not new at this, Ruggero Ricci, Joe Langlin, Josh Bell, Maxim Vengerov, he had made a cello for Yo-Yo Ma, Lelo Yosefowicz, Dilana Jensen, and of course Daniel Phillips, who's playing today, and Daniel's brother Todd. He made them for members of the Emerson String Quartet and Brooklyn Rider. And here's something that's kind of brand new information. Sam has been consulting with physicists, engineers, and violinists and violin makers to work on a new project called Strad 3D Project. And they have already made the first 3D modal analysis of Cremonese or instruments from Cremona. So they're actually beginning to do extraordinary things with the technology. And I'll say something about Danny, and then we'll bring Sam out first. Danny is very well known to New Yorkers, a great violinist, beloved by audiences everywhere, a master teacher as well. And recently, in his quartet, the Orion String Quartet, they just did all the Beethoven, they participated in the Beethoven cycle at the Chamber Music Society. They will be doing the complete quartets of Leon Kirshner later in May on an internet, live internet broadcast. And Danny's playing the Mendelssohn Concerto with the New Amsterdam Symphony at Symphony Space on April 8th. So if you feel like going to hear him right away, whether he's playing on a Sigmundowicz or a Strad that day, I don't know. But so let's please welcome Samuel Sigmundowicz to begin with. Sam?
Thank you very much. It's a real honor to be here. I want to thank Bruce for inviting me and MoMath. And I have to say that when I told some of my friends I was going to be speaking at an event sponsored by MoMath, I heard some snickers, because anyone who knows me knows that it takes me a while to figure out the tip when I'm in a restaurant. I'm not a mathematician, and I'm not really a scientist, or an engineer. But I've had the remarkable good fortune to be able to collaborate with some amazing minds. And we're in an interesting time where there's a remarkable openness from many sides. And technology has, the entry level for a lot of technology has come so low that you can do things with a laptop that were just inconceivable a small number of years ago. And when it comes to violin making, the new technology is interesting, but what's even more interesting is the old technology. The violin is really a monumental piece of pre-modern engineering that has really resisted analysis until recently. There's a lot of puzzles in it, a lot of sophistication in the design, and it is sort of an amazing monument to how collective human thinking can produce an amazingly effective artifact. So a lot of my use of technology and analysis is not to redesign the violin necessarily, but to start to pick apart how it actually works. Why is it the way that it is? So I'll be talking about that more. For the moment, I am also very, very honored and touched to be on this program with Daniel Phillips. And Daniel Phillips was really an early mentor. He lived in Brooklyn, not far from where my workshop was. And he was very interested in violins. And for one thing, as you'll see when he plays, he's known among musicians for having one of the most informed and sensitive approaches to violin tone production, and just the mechanics of how expression happens on the instrument. And he was very generous in coming over to my shop from time to time and trying my violins and giving me the feedback that I needed, because the truth about the violin is that people think of it as a wooden box, but really the violin is a violin when it's played by a violinist. Otherwise, it's just a piece of wood until that moment. So I'm really pleased to be able to bring Daniel Phillips out. He'll be playing two violins. One is a Stradivari that is now called the Phillips Strad, a beautiful instrument. He also has a violin that I made. And it's not an exaggeration for me to say that Danny was very important in me developing my own making. So I'm really honored to be here with him.
Yeah, let's get two fiddles. He's got one already, and we're not telling you which is which. Did you follow that there were recently professional wine tasters, and they couldn't even tell blindfolded if it was red or white? And these people drive up the prices, et cetera. Okay, so we've got two instruments here, and you are going to hear a real performance of a whole piece, but first, some segments, fragments, in order to compare the instruments just for fun. So, some Bach, yes? Okay. Do we want to reveal anything yet? Does anybody want to hazard a guess which one is which, or what is old or new, or what is... what did you say? The first one was the Strad? Well, actually, the first one is by Sam Sigmundovich. Yay! We're so glad you got that wrong. You see, you have to understand, this is for, we have a lot of young people in the audience, and I want you to know that getting things wrong is sometimes much better. This was an example of that. If they got it right, we'd be all disappointed. So you get as much wrong as you want. In fact, if you want to be an inventor, you have to get almost everything wrong until you get it right. So it's good. Okay, so which one are you going to, you're going to play Sam's instrument now. It's better anyway. Yes, and you're going to play the entire Adagio and Fugue.
Wow. Oh, I need to catch my breath after that. It is, whenever I hear a violinist like that play, it makes me feel like as a violin maker, I'm part of something big. It's very gratifying. Okay, well, thank you very much. It was an interesting invitation to come and talk about the math, science, and art of the violin. So I made a little bit of an effort to actually talk about the math and science and art of the violin. I won't so much be talking about workshop procedure, which is interesting in its own right. There's plenty of workshop math, calculating wood density, figuring out proportions, measuring. I mean, you could make a long list of things that you use math for in every activity, and violin making maybe more than some. But the violin is also comes out of a world that world view that was soaked in a vision that married a mathematical view of the world to a religious and philosophical view of the world that goes back to Pythagoras. The questions that as a violin maker I find myself asking, and this object which seems so compelling, and I think that the violin and the world of the violin is very compelling, and it's been the subject of hundreds and hundreds of relatively trivial newspaper articles about the secret of Strad and whatever else. But so everyone feels that there's something deep about the violin, and there's something a little bit beyond what they can easily see. But people have differed on what they think that is behind the violin. And nowadays, people tend to look for what's the trick, what's the secret. And in earlier times, I think they saw everything that an artist and a craftsman did with their art as at least an intent, a reflection of the universe around them that they considered to be built on a basis of order and beauty. And they tried to reflect that order and beauty in their own work. And it's a kind of magical thinking, but it's not a bad principle as far as it goes. Before we get deep into it, I'll just take a little detour into my own work. In my everyday work, I am a violin maker. I make new instruments by commission. My shop is in Brooklyn, and it all starts with wood, which is the opposite of philosophical. It's very tangible material. But it turns out to be a very sophisticated material, and it was used very shrewdly by makers of the past. For example, all European string instruments have spruce tops, because they all figured out independently at different places, and that spruce of the European woods was the strongest per unit of weight. It was used for ship's masts, and so it's the most resonant, not necessarily the toughest. And so it's used on violins and gambas and harpsichords and lutes. So in my own work, my job is to take piles of wood and turn it into instruments. So this was a quartet that I worked on for Brooklyn Rider. This is about most of the way through, and here it is finished. And this is sort of where this is the proof of all the effort comes to the moment when you actually place instruments into a musician's hands. And it's a very fraught moment, because especially the better the musicians you work with, the more demanding they are, and the more chance that there is that they will say, not really. So being able to do a good job, an adequate job, becomes very important. It's not just an intellectual exercise. So years ago, when Danny asked me to make him a violin, that was nice of him, and he's a nice guy. But if it wasn't a good violin, he was going to be polite, but he wasn't going to buy it or play it. So it's a very fraught endeavor. So this is me in my workshop, and it's a peaceful place. It's a nice place. Now this is a different workshop. Some of you may recognize this. This is a workshop from 500 years ago, but it's It's pretty similar in a lot of ways. For one thing, I'm often in that kind of mood when I just can't seem to get anything done. My dog is often kind of depressed when I won't take her to the park. But you see a lot of things there that are, you know, well, I have a clock, but they had a hourglass with the sands ticking away. And I don't really keep so many geometrical solids to... and then the tools that are in the picture are not that different. I could use those tools very easily today. And you'll see there's a plane, a saw, and a straight edge. And in her hand is a divider. And over here is my divider. And this is the quintessential ancient design tool. It doesn't have has very few moving parts, no mechanical measurement, and you know we tend to think now in terms of like there's a definitive measurement. You know, you make it 1 foot long, and then you make it 6 inches wide. You know, in the Renaissance and the post-Renaissance, every town might have its own ruler. So it was kind of, if you were a mason, for example, the masons, their symbol is the divider and the square. Because if you went to a different town, they might have a different ruler. You still have to build a cathedral there. So most design techniques were built around proportion. All you needed is one fixed measurement to start. And then everything else was built around that measure. And you have to, if you have to design some way, then nature is really one of the best engineer. And the people studied nature very closely to see how things worked. And it was a principle, which is not always true at a certain level, but generally it is a good principle that when something is beautiful, it will be effective. So in the absence of higher level engineering, that's a pretty good way to build things. So that's a nautilus shell you'll all recognize. And people worked out using dividers and straight edges only, all kinds of very ingenious drawing techniques. This is a rendering of a scroll using very ancient techniques. It's built off of a rectangle that is four parts on one side, three parts on the other. And these kind of measurements, which actually derive from the harmonic series, actually, your violin's put away. Is it put away? Oh, well. Okay, well, while he's getting that out, I mean, you know, people who are into pi, it's a number that, it's, you know, people take pride in being able to see how many digits they could memorize. However, you can also express pi as in drawings, that certain kind of drawings will produce that ratio naturally. And there's all these other similar ratios, like 1 to 2 is a ratio. Play first an open string. So that's 1. There's the octave. That's 1 to 1. Is that 3? That's a fifth above. The string's vibrating in threes now. Octave above. So what's happening there, he's gently touching the string in different points, and he's creating a little spot where the string can't vibrate. So the string first is just vibrating in one hole, and then he's touching it in the middle, and then all of a sudden it can't vibrate there, so it's vibrating in two loops. So the ancients saw that long ago. The monochord was a teaching tool of philosophy, not math, and math actually as well. So these kind of proportions, 3 to 4, 1 to 2, 3 to 4, 5 to 7, they're all different proportions, and you can actually juggle the books and kind of make anything you want and still feel like you're being very philosophical and divine about it. So. A colleague of mine who was also a participant in Strad 3D has made the most convincing recreation of the geometrical drawing techniques that were likely used by all the way back to the Renaissance and before. Right now, this is an animation that Francois has on his website where he's drawing a violin using proportion. It started with one fixed measure from which he drew a square. And then that extends down, and using very ingenious use of different proportions, you can create the outline that we know. What's amazing about it is not just that it works and that it's clever, but that it is actually a very, very accurate way to transmit information. When I learned in school, you know, if we wanted a model, we'd find somebody who had a Strad or had knew somebody who had a Strad, and we would like lay it down on a piece of paper and trace it. It's very analog, you could say. And the French makers, when they got interested in copying Strad, they would copy each other's templates. And over time, their violins got bigger and bigger because the thickness of the pencil line built up. But with this technique, it's actually, it's a digital technique. There's no slop in it, actually. It's a series of coordinates. And I could let this run if you're interested in it, or we could move on. But this is, you could make, Francois, for a demonstration, did a 100-meter long violin on a beach. There's a video on it on YouTube taken from a plane using a rope and, you know, as a compass. And you could also do the same thing to make the world's smallest violin, to play the world's saddest song with nanotechnology, probably. So here's, on one side is the same viola you just saw drawn in that animation. There's my drawing of it, which I did in a course with Francois. And on the other side, over here, is Francois' directions for it. And you don't need the image, actually. I could email directions for how to draw a Strad or a Guarneri to you. Not a long email, no images. It's interesting that it was a very, we think of digital technology as something very modern, but it's actually a reflection of an abstract way of viewing reality, and that reality is just a projection forward of archetypical forms. I've been working with Professor Harry Mayerson from Brandeis University. Working with means like he's doing the work, but he's, and I comment on it. But he's working on something called the Digital Amati Project, because basically what he's been working with Francois, he's a professor of computer science, but he's an amateur cello maker, and he was working with Francois' method, which is effective but a little cumbersome if you want to make variations, and he realized it was code. It was a type of computer code, and it's a contingent code because each line is dependent on where the last one was. So you change one parameter, everything shifts with it. So he developed this software and is still developing it further now, where you can feed these coordinates into it, which just instruct it where to put your compass point and where to draw the arc, and that will determine where the next compass point goes. So. And that brings us to this object that, one of the things that happened since the time of the great makers is that a lot of the traditional technology got lost. So it's not that there wasn't technology before, and it's not that there are secrets per se. There's just things that we no longer remember. For a long time, that systematic way of looking at things was lost. And now we're in the process of trying to recreate that. And one of the things is, you know, it brings us to the idea of what is a violin, really. And, you know, the ancients, they couldn't really see vibration. So they kind of encased their design. Once they worked it out, they encased it in this fixed digital formula that they could tell their students what to do. What's great about tradition is that, you know, once in a while there's a really smart person who works out a good design, and then they force their students to do that, because not everybody is a genius. So tradition is great in getting a lot of people to work at a pretty good level with an intermittent genius once in a while just to notch it up a little bit. But the thing that is happening now is, you know, we realized it then, but we realize it more now, that all the important parts of the violin are things that we can't see, which are vibration and the way it interacts with the musician. And so there's a different view of the violin that I like to keep in my mind when I'm working, which is the violin is more like I'm not an electrics engineer, but a transistor or a capacitor or something. The violinist is on one end of it, and he's feeding energy into it through his bow. And it's basically like he's pushing the violin around, the violin's deforming, and then it's trying to return to rest. And as it returns to rest, it's releasing that energy in the form of vibration. And those vibrations come out there's many different frequencies, and the violin will vibrate in many different ways, and it vibrates completely according to its nature. It's very, you know, people used to think that the violin had a sound the way that they used to think a person had a soul, as something that was separate. And now I think we see humans differently. We realize that a person has a personality, and if they have a bad day, their personality is not so great. It's changed, you know. So the same thing with a violin. Change the structure, change the sound. So how can we see what we can't normally see? And I will say that violin acoustics are in a way, it's still a very rudimentary level. I mean, they're amazing, but compared to what can happen, it's still, you know, really there could be no serious study of the acoustics of the violin until we had computerized sound recording and sound analysis. There's some heavy-duty mathematics in that I can't pretend to get into, but back to the harmonic series, which is the basis of all this. So there's one, the open string. There's 2-to-1 octave. There's 3, which was the fifth. There's 4, which is the octave up again, on and on and on and on and on. So what we don't realize, and what we couldn't realize until now, this is a bowed open G string on the Titian Strad. Just to explain this graph, this is what's called a sound spectrum. Like, you know, a light spectrum shows the colors of light contained within white light. This shows the frequencies contained in any sound. So going from bottom to top is loudness, and going from left to right is frequency. So down here, can you see the cursor up there? Yeah. That is what would be the fundamental of the open G down there. That's around 200 roughly. And then all these other peaks here, those are little hot spots that are being recorded. And they're not all recorded, they're not all being amplified at the same level. Like the fundamental, which is what we think of as the real basis of the note, is actually a little lower than most of the others. The physicists count this different than musicians, but the first or the second harmonic, depending on how you count, is actually much stronger than the first. And so we have 200, 400, 600, 800. It's all very orderly. And every bowed note contains this bouquet of harmonics in it. And depending on the distribution of those harmonics, that'll give you the timbre of the sound. Actually, Danny, is your violin still out? You should just keep it up.
Which one?
Whichever you like. And you know, the violin amplifies these various harmonics based on its capabilities. But the violinist is actually using those capabilities, play like almost up on the fingerboard very delicately, and then gradually start pulling in towards the bridge. As you like, a note probably. Really close to the bridge now.
What?
Really close. And then back up. The closer he gets to the bridge, it activates more of the high harmonics of the sound. So if we were running a sound analyzer, we would see the high harmonics start to really pump up there. Just do it again so they can hear how much. This is what he went to Juilliard for. but I mean, the violinist works with the structure of the instrument and the physics of the instrument. That's what gives a musician the expressive range. Coming closer to the bridge is actually one of the chief techniques, because you're changing not only the loudness but the timbre of the sound. So we'll get it. We'll continue with that in a minute, but that's just an idea of what we're using this technology, and there's a formula called a fast Fourier transform, which some of you know what it is, not me. But it's a way to turn a recorded sound into a snapshot that contains all the harmonics within that sound. So this gives us an ability to see sound in a way that we didn't before. Violinists and violin makers tend to think about the mechanics of it very metaphorically, not inaccurately, but just they describe it in ways that feel right. But when it comes time to analyze things, you need something more than just the metaphoric language. You actually need real descriptive language. So, I mean, you wouldn't say if you were describing that note necessarily that you're favoring the high harmonics, but you know, you're intensifying it, you're giving it more spin, you're making the sound more pointed. You'd have all kinds of words that work from a musical point of view, but they're metaphors for the physical phenomena. This is just another study I'm going to refer to. One of the questions is, you know, how did the violin get to be the way it is? Because it didn't start out the way it is. And this study was in the papers not that long ago. It was done at MIT, Evolution of Air Resonance, Power Efficiency in the Violin and Its Ancestors. But as you can see, the earliest instruments, Rebec and things like that, they just had round holes, which are a very pleasing form. There's something a little different. And then there's this C hole. We're into the 13th century now. Here in the 15th and 16th, we have this kind of another kind of C hole with little tabs. Another one. And then until we get to the modern violin F hole, which still continued to change in the classical period. So why did they do that? This MIT study, even though it got a lot of press, I have to say it was a very narrow study. It was focused on one mode of the violin. Basically, like if you blow over a Coke bottle and you get that woo, the violin has a body of air inside it as well that has a resonance. And what they found, both through both experimentally and through mathematical modeling, was that when you had a wide opening, these different colors are showing the velocity of air coming out of the instrument, out of the cavity. So blue is basically low velocity, and these yellow is high velocity, and that means how much the sound is projecting. So with a round hole, you're getting relatively low efficiency of getting that particular mode out into the world. With all these other shapes, you're basically increasing the perimeter of the hole. So since the perimeter is the place where you have the highest efficiency, as if any of you have walked across town in Manhattan in February, and you know how you know that icy wind comes blowing down those narrow streets, or if you walk around a corner, it can just practically blow you over. Well, they figured that out too when it came to sound. Now, F holes are much more complex than that, but this is at least one element to begin to show what are some of the physics behind the empirical experimentation that happened little by little by little, which is a real testament to just human persistence and ingenuity. When I got a little deeper into this, I'm part of a program called the Oberlin Violin Acoustics Workshop. And there I got to work with a number of physicists and engineers. And there's a project I got involved with. Basically, I was the Strad Wrangler. They had the opportunity to do laser scanning, vibration scanning, and the company that makes these lasers was willing to offer them a 3D scanner, which had never been used on violins before. But they wanted to tell the board of directors that they were going to scan a Strad. So that's where I got into it. I had to come up with the Strad, and I had to make sure nobody broke it. So we did a bunch of tests on it. We had a few days where we did, we did laser modal scanning, CT scanning, which is where I'm starting here. We put three Cremonese instruments. That's, I think, at the time that was $11 million, and now it's probably double that, of violins through this scanner. And Dr. Bissinger, who is the lead on this, had built this rig because he thought it was more economical to put them through in a batch. So what we're seeing now is the axial view. That means little cross sections going through this Betz Stradivari from 1704. And there's all kinds of things you can learn from CT scans. You can see density, you can see damage. But one of the things you see is just these very, very, very pleasing forms. And it is strangely moving to see, you know, the forms of both interior and exterior. They're like sine waves or bell curves. It is amazing how harmonious and pleasing just the shapes are. Now, of course, this is great reference for a maker as well, to be able to see the carving. And wood density is something, density, that you can't normally see with your eyes. And in analyzing old instruments, now we have a body of information that you weren't able to see before. Another thing we did there, which is modal analysis. A mode on a violin, it's sort of like a harmonic on a on a string. You know, any object, when you deform it, it starts to bend, and it bends in big motions in the most obvious ways first. So if I got shoved, you know, I would, you know, like that, maybe this is my first mode is probably this, and then my second might be this, and then my third, you know, my 15th mode might be this, you know, so an object will vibrate in many, many, many different ways. And each of those vibrations will be a different speed. You know, if I'm moving this arm, it's just, it goes slower, whereas if I'm moving my finger, I can go a lot faster. And each of those modes will produce a different speed of vibration, which will reinforce a different musical frequency. So the structure of the violin gives you its modes give you its resonance potential gives you its response to the stimuli from the violinist, gives you its timbre. So we're going to see some of this the animations that were done with this. It's basically the same process that's used in like a Pixar stop action animation, where an actor wears a suit and they just watch where the sensors go. Basically, the lasers scanned the strad at all these different points as it was vibrated. And then they created this 3D model. And then it's going to vibrate in real ways. This is not constructed, what I'm about to show you. Let's start. This is the Titian Stradivari modal analysis. These are real motions. However, they are extremely exaggerated in size and extremely slowed down. Because normally, this is happening all the time when someone plays, but you just can't see it. So they've slowed it down and exaggerated so you can see what's going on. The numbers down below, this is the number of cycles per second that it's vibrating at. And that you'll see as it goes through it, the vibration patterns are changing. And when you see it, it's like, you know, you think of the, you know, musicians, I think all of them feel that their instrument is alive. And now, it might not be alive like we're alive, but it looks pretty alive. And I mean, as shocking as these images are in a way, I think they're quite intuitive in a different way, because, you know, a musician can feel that something exciting is happening underneath their chin. So that's the organized part of this. And then we can, actually, would you play your violin one more time?
Which one, here?
Sure, yes. You know, all the things I'm showing you, they may seem, you know, fussy or technical, but they're very, very, very tangible. And the thing about, you know, like I said, like the violin being a conduit for transmitting energy from one place to another, it's very, very real. And as a maker, I mean, I take that as a responsibility quite seriously, because, you know, if his equipment won't do it, it doesn't matter how hard he tries, it'll still sound great because he plays great, but you won't hear it as great. So. But I'm just going to show you some of these modes. You don't need lasers. Just
play, find a note that's like a hotter note.
Vibrating as I touch it, I'm muting it just a tiny little bit.
So,
you're not so much, right? You're nothing. Pick a different note. Not only does the sound changing, but it changes in different ways as I touch different spots.
because I'm muting different harmonics of the sound in different spots. So I'm changing the timbre. Time, we could map out the modal structure of this violin just by with our fingertips with his playing. It'd be annoying, but anyway, just to say, all this is, you know, the math and the science is fun to use technology, but you know, it's real. It's very tangible right in front of us. And as a maker, you know, it makes me feel differently about my work. Instead of feeling like a glorified carpenter, I feel like I'm really helping create this pathway for sound. Anyway, I'm done.
Okay, what we're going to do now is take some questions from you, for Sam and Danny, and I'm here to facilitate in some way. So, and then Danny will play a little dessert before you go. All right, so think of your questions, and remember, they should be metaphorical and poetic. With a hint of mathematics and possibly an intimidating formula or equation for those around you. Now, you take that mic, yeah, okay. So who's got a question to start? Yes, sir.
The viola has a wonderful sound, but it seems to me that have a different character from the violin and the cello, and yet it looks quite similar. Why is that?
Okay, the question was, the viola, which has a wonderful character and sound, has a different personality or character than the violin, and why is that?
Well, one of the things is that the viola is a real challenge in terms of its physics and ergonomics, because by rights, if you took the violin as an ideal proportion for the frequency, for the melodic range it plays in, and that's pretty good, but the viola would have to be much larger than a person could comfortably play to be the same proportion musically. So ergonomically, you have to make compromises. So that's one of the reasons. So with violas, making violas, you always have to try to kind of squeeze a little more instrument into a smaller package. That's one of the reasons. And you're a violist.
You want to say something since you play viola?
Well, I don't know. It's a lower pitch. So, but, and it's more airspace, so it's just it would be the same as a mezzo soprano versus a soprano, just the capacity of the what vibrates in it.
I'm sure you know Peter and Wendy Moos a little bit, right? These are violin makers who now live in Germany, but they've been making a six-string viola. Have you seen this instrument?
I have not, no.
I'll just say, I took a look at one. They're making a six-string viola that is like a violin viola. It has an E, so it's an E and an A and a D and a G and a C. And they're finding that some people really enjoy it.
Well, it's really fun. Depends on the music you play, but a lot of jazz players or people who use electronic instruments have at least a five-string instrument, because if you use amplification, you can make up for the lack of acoustic body space, and then it's really fun to, like, you're playing, and all of a sudden you've got a whole nother room on your house, you know?
I have a question, and then while you're thinking, since we know that the F-hole was developed from an inefficient round hole, why does the classical guitar, which is the quietest instrument on the face of the earth, still have a round hole in the middle of it?
Well, one of the things, like I said, the way an instrument works is you're basically deforming it with an impulse, right? So you're pushing it, and then it's trying to return. The quicker it returns, the louder it is, and the shorter it rings. Like a banjo would be a very efficient instrument. Boing, done. Whereas a classical guitar, what you want is, since you're not bowing it, you want the note to linger. Boing. So in a way, you could say that the classical guitar is deliberately inefficient in order to gain more sustain and tonal quality. Whereas like a jazz guitars were F-hole guitars with an arch top.
Exactly.
And those were loud, and those were made to be played with in the early days of big bands with minimal amplification. Right. So they didn't care about sustain, they cared about punch.
Oh, that's, well, there you have a really good answer. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Early in your conversation, you were describing your challenges to construct a violin that the performer would find a good sound. What is the characteristic of something that wouldn't have a good sound? How do you contrast the two?
Oh, good question. What is something, the characteristic of an instrument that doesn't have a good sound?
Well, you could ask him what he wouldn't play. But
viola. No, he does play viola.
Well, well, I mean, you can sort of divide the categories of function of an instrument into what I consider to be technical. Well, first of all, there's ergonomics. It's got to be comfortable to play. You can't be straining. You can't be twisting yourself too much. Neck can't be too thick or clunky. And then there is what I would call technical, which is like, when you play, does it respond? When you play harder, do you get more sound out, or does it just bottom out? So you can have a violin that doesn't necessarily sound that great, but you can still play great music on it because technically it gives you the range of response you need to interact with it. So to me, that's a must, that it has to have the technical ability to let a musician have the range of expression. So you have to be able to play loud, you have to be able to say play soft. Part of the challenge is to make a sound that will be project well and still not be obnoxious to the player, basically.
And isn't it true that a lot of the student instruments or the cheap instruments are just made of really bad wood, but what else is wrong with them?
Say that again?
Aside from bad wood, what are the cheap student instruments? What's wrong with them aside from bad wood?
Well, it's not even necessarily bad wood. It's a big business in most violin shops to buy inexpensive instruments, take them apart and do surgery on them and turn them into much better instruments. Mostly there's, the difference between one of the worst violins and one of the best violins is, relatively speaking, not that big. They're all recognizably violins. You can buy a $200 violin, and you could play it. You know, you might not love it. You get into smaller increments of quality, which means smaller and smaller increments of basically giving two things, giving the player range to express themselves musically and letting people hear it well. So mostly it's a matter of optimization. Those same bad violins, if I was inclined, I could spend an afternoon with them or a couple of days and make them much, 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 much better. So I am interested in violin innovation and design, but actually most of what we do is just doing it the same way, but just better. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
Good
okay,
question.
On a string instrument, what does the mute do to dampen the sound?
For those who don't know, a mute is a little piece of wood. It looks like a tiny little clothespin, and you clip it on the bridge, and it makes the violin sound much quieter. It turns out, like, you know how I described the violin as being kind of like a filter, for a sound filter? The bridge is the biggest sound filter on the violin. The design of the violin bridge is designed to filter out some frequencies and to transmit some other ones selectively. It's vibrating itself. So a little weight on top of the bridge will really slow down the way it moves. So what you're mostly cutting is you're cutting the high frequencies out of the violin with even a small amount. I thought about doing that as an experiment, but you could put a gram, like a lentil's worth of clay on your bridge and you would hear the difference dramatically. The bridge itself has a tuning. Actually, that's something we know a lot more about than we used to. You can use a computer, actually, if you want to really control the tuning of the violin bridge, which will change. You know, the bridge has, in itself, is kind of like a mute already. It's but if it's a thick bridge, it's really more of a mute. So, different shops who have different tastes and sound will make bridges which are heavier or lighter, which will give violinists a different kind of sound. And people go to those shops depending on their taste. So a mute is just a more extreme version of that.
Is that your father asking now? Okay. Yeah, okay.
The cutouts of the bridge, have those changed over time?
The question is the cutouts that you see in the image there of the bridge, which are obviously to affect the weight and therefore the sound, have those changed?
Yes, they have. And even now, different shops have different models, as I said, slightly. And the bridge is just, it's a little like almost a parlor trick, but sometimes if I'm doing an adjustment with someone and we're just trying to brighten up the violin, I'll just take a knife on the violin while it's strung up and just take a little slice, like a little shaving off the side,
and they can hear it like right away. It just little like just brightens up a little bit. It's dramatic how much you can do. If you took it to an extreme, the sound would start to sound a little harsh to us. I mean there is, you know, we talked about spectra before, and there's a definite response curve which is pleasant, and other areas where, you know, some areas of that spectrum, certain frequency regions are associated with fullness of sound, other areas are associated with projection and brilliance, other areas would be associated with hiss and noise. So, you know, part of what we're doing with those little cuts, so they're kind of like little tuned sound absorbers, if you will. If you cut away all that extra junk, the bridge would be louder, but not nicer.
So I think we have time for a couple more questions. So good. Yes, right there.
I'm curious if you look at Stradivarius, like a whole bunch of different ones, and what the sound variation
is. What's the sound variation within a Strad family?
It's huge. You know, that's one of the things when people say, what's the secret of a Strad? I always find it kind of an impossible question to even begin to answer, because they're all so different than each other. I mean, the best ones and the best old instruments, this is something that Danny and I have talked a lot about, which is that the best old instruments give the widest, they allow a very soft attack into the string and still allow the scope to go deeper and more intense. Some, you know, less good instruments, old, but, you know, it's also a flaw of many, many very powerful new instruments are when you sort of begin the bow note, it can be a little bit like making a dive, but instead of being a clean dive, it's a little bit of a belly flop, and you sort of feel the sting as you begin the note. I don't know how few would describe it that way, but the best Strads, I think, are very pleasant at the beginning of the note, which makes them appealing to play. Not necessarily, you know, audiences don't like it necessarily any better, but as the subjective experience of playing can be more seductive.
Okay, one or two more. We have so many people. First, way up there, yes? Relationship. I think everyone heard that. You have a very good projection yourself. I had a joke there, but I'm not going to say it. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, well, you're changing two things when you change the thickness. I mean, every wood, its three properties are stiffness, mass, and damping. So as you make it thinner, you're removing mass, which in general will make it more efficient, but you're lowering stiffness. So up to a point, the violin will get louder. And at a certain point, it might start losing brilliance. There's no absolute rule about how thick or thin it should be, but that's how you decide. When you thin it, you're simultaneously removing mass and lowering stiffness. So you have to do it very strategically. Old instruments are often quite variable in their thickness, more than you would expect.
I'm not going to be able to call on everyone, so don't be mad about that. But what? Oh, yes, okay, sorry. Your question is, does Sam, when he's making an instrument, take into consideration the shoulder rest? If the player uses one, yeah.
A shoulder rest is like a little, it clips onto the sides of the violin and it raises the violin up a little bit. It makes it easier to hold, and it also means the violin's not touching your shoulder. It is a real factor. This also relates to the matter of thickness. A violin which is very responsive is more likely to also get a little muted if it's put directly on the shoulder, and will likely be helped by having a shoulder rest to hold it off. On the other hand, a violin that, just for an example, Cho Lang Lin, who's a wonderful violinist, has one of my favorite Strads, the Titian Strad, and he doesn't use a shoulder rest. And one time for an experiment, we just tried with a shoulder rest, and the violin didn't sound quite as nice. It sounded a little, you would say, objectively speaking, it had a little more sound, but probably what was being absorbed by his shoulder was something we didn't want to hear so much of. So there's no absolute rule. Generally, people use shoulder rests based on their playing needs and their ergonomics, and then you adapt to whatever they need to be comfortable.
Well, that's very interesting. Yes, sir, right there.
Great question. When you fix a crack on a violin, can you
fix how it sounds. One of the ways you fix the crack is you glue it, and then usually they glue little pieces of wood cross-grain inside to keep the crack from flexing too much. So it keeps the crack from flexing, but it stiffens the violin. And actually, it's a subject I'm very interested in. It's a big subject. Sometimes it's done deliberately in shops, but I've been exploring using reinforcements to basically micro-engineer a violin. So you can do kind of amazing things with that by adding selective stiffness in places. So, yes.
Yes, sir.
When I listen to a Strat, I hear the power, and your instruments also have a great deal of power. But I think what the Strat has, all the ones I've heard, is this metaphorically speaking, this incredible sweetness. It's almost a honey sound that I've never heard any violin ever do the same, the copy. Do you agree with that? Do you think that the Strats are as sweet as I'm saying they are?
Boy, that's a very personal question on both ends.
Permission to speak frankly?
Yeah. Well, I just, before, while you think about that, I have to say you're completely correct about your opinion. that you have it. Okay, go ahead.
Right. Well, first of all, many people will agree with you, or certainly feel that way. One of the things when people say sweet, the language that's used to describe sound, like I said, people talk about sound metaphorically. Sweet is not actually a sound word, it's a taste word. So what does it mean? It means different things to different people. So I find it not as useful a word as could be because it's interpreted very differently by different people for starts. I personally prefer words that are more onomatopoetic, like hiss or pop or buzz or boom, you know, they're sort of, they translate to their sound words. Yeah. But back to your point, it's a few years ago, there's some friends of mine, you can find this if you Google it very easily, just Google blind test Strads. These have been done for a long time, but they did some very well controlled ones where they had some Strads and Guarnerys and some new violins, and they had a variety of musicians try them. Wearing dark glasses so they couldn't exactly see what they were playing. They didn't drop them, but they couldn't see. And they put a drop of cologne on the chin rest so they couldn't smell what they were playing. And what they found is that people were relatively consistent in what they preferred. They could tell one violin from another violin, and they had their favorites. But they were almost useless as far as telling Strads from new violins. These were really good new violins. And they did not necessarily, as a rule, prefer the Strads. So I think the takeaway was that people like what they like, and that there's a lot of mystique, you know. And I think just, you know, on that topic, I mean, I think people have made this like Strad versus new violins. Is anyone going to dethrone Strad? And when people now in some of these blind tests, when the new violins are preferred, you know, half the time, it doesn't mean that Strads aren't great. It just means that Strad is not only a great maker, he's a great teacher. Makers like myself, we spend a lot of time studying them, and it's no miracle that if people spend a lot of time really closely emulating something, they start to approach it. So, and that's been a developing process.
I think this is a great way to now, unless you, do you have something to add to that?
Yeah, very
okay,
quickly.
Go ahead. Yeah, no, yeah, and then we'll play something.
Yes. Well, I took my violin for repair for many decades to the great René Morel, who's world famous as being one of the great repair people in the world. Sam also worked with him very closely and worked in his shop even for many years. So I asked René one day, I told him you've seen probably most of the great existing instruments of all time, and you've worked on them, and you make them sound better. What's the secret? And he said, art.
But then he fired Art, and he had to get her an impression. Okay, so now let's hear a little Fritz Kreisler. After Danny plays Liebesfreude of Fritz Kreisler,
rather than talk some more, make your way out there. There's wine and blindfolds. No, there are no blindfolds. So that you can taste the wine, see if it's red or white. And if you really want to test now, just see if, put your fingers in your ears and see what it does to the listening to the, so.